away their so-called abusers doesn't make it right. But that very thing is what oppressed people in this country are so accustomed to. So there's no sense of alarm about it. They're accustomed to being wrongfully accused. They're accustomed to being wrongfully imprisoned. In fact, this tactic comes out of the standard tactic of this oppressive system that targets communities to get the desired result. The great liberal Bill Clinton created the world's largest prison industrial complex on the same tactic. Because all these prisons are built, they now have to be filled, the judges now have to find people guilty, and then people found a way to say, well, hey, I could accuse people of a crime, and they are gone. There's a lot of room for them. Only a couple of years ago did he say that he regretted creating this large prison industrial complex. But by then, what is the point? It's not about how you feel, it's about what you did. How many families were destroyed? How many futures were destroyed? By people understanding intuitively they have the power to do these things. And so they do them. And that's where the women's movement is right now. They understand they have the power to do certain things, and they do it. And they're getting results. The people they have marked are suffering incredibly. There's no trial, there's no evidence, just an accusation. What can the women's movement do? And what can women do? And I suspect that there would be a lot to learn going back to the old ways in some cases. Where we do not see men as the enemy, but as vital parts of the vitality and the continuity of our communities. We're not supposed to be siding with women who are behaving in a contradictory way. We're supposed to be calling them to account. We're supposed to be warning them. We're supposed to be saying, hey, you're going too fast, and you're throwing the baby out of the bathwater. Be very careful about what you're doing, because you are about to destroy communities, whole communities on the basis of this. But then again, if we review the record, we see that in oppressed communities, they've already been conditioned to accept this. This kind of treatment, unequal treatment in the law. Now, they've upped the ante, and the women are behind a very bad movement, I think. Well-intentioned, perhaps, of weeding out unsavory characters, but you don't get points for being unsavory in your actions. You don't get points for that. And they have to be called out on it, because I see it as being one of the most damaging developments in our recent history. And the fact that women seem to be gleeful about it, that they have arrived at the point of power where they can make these kinds of things happen, they've crossed the line, seriously. And they take satisfaction in gaining individual victories, but believe me, it is going to be a very serious fallout, not just in the United States. Because as you know, what happens in the United States in many instances is copied in other countries. So we shouldn't be surprised that we will find this phenomenon occurring, and soon as you look at it, soon you will have a global effect of injustice ushered into existence by women. Are they prepared for the responsibility of that? I don't know. But they should understand that they are engaging in a very dicey kind of politics. It's not going to yield what they think it ought to yield. They'll get the satisfaction of knowing that individually they have solved a problem, but they've created a devastating situation. And let's also be clear that it is all happening in the context of white supremacy. This is white supremacist thinking, backward thinking. I can get even with you by using the same nasty tactics that you use. That does not advance the cause at all. And I go back to some of these instructions that we can get and have been getting, but ignoring, from so-called third world or backward societies, they would say, where the issue is survival of the family and survival of community. That's what women outside of this system choose. The attitude is that whatever American women choose, that's it. It's the right way, and it ought to be replicated all over the world. And that's exactly my fear. The women do not seem to understand what they're doing, the consequences of what they're doing. And I'm not suggesting that anybody overlook sexual assault and sexual abuse. But you have to see if you intend to be useful and if you intend to struggle for a just world, you have to see the big picture. And as you look at the big picture, the only thing you can see is inevitably, there will be irreparable harm on the very structure that could save us, which is family and community. It is considered now quite reactionary to promote family and community. It's considered to be very advanced to be all about yourself. I'm a woman, hear me roar. And if it's good for me, it's therefore is good, period. That is a retrograde way of thinking. A very counter-revolutionary way of thinking. Nobody survives when the architecture is falling apart. Nobody survives. Because survival is linked to the strength of family and community. Plain and simple. So if anything, the work to be done here is to issue a wake-up call. You're destroying the possibility for survival. It's not just about you and your fight. And the way you choose to resolve it is to just point a finger and get somebody destroyed and then you move on. That's not the way it is. Not in many communities. And the country has lost so much. All over the world, you see it. When people refuse to pay attention to their cultural norms, their cultural heritage, and they think, they cast them aside, thinking that they're passé, there's no value to them. But if they pay attention, even in the most war-torn countries, what do the people do? They do everything possible to save their families and to save their communities. They're not interested in who's fighting who. And who's winning the war? They're interested in what is left of my family. What is going to be left of my family? because it relates now to my survival and the survival of my people. And this is the mentality we ought to have. Go past all the razzmatazz and get down to the business of how does this help me survive? How does this help my community survive? How does this help our nation survive in a healthy way? If it doesn't do that, you don't need it. You don't need it. So that's where we are. We have to make some decisions, and we have to start calling people out. They have to account for their recklessness, because they're being reckless. They see the short term, and short term satisfaction of winning against men. They're not seeing how they're actually fulfilling the requirements of a repressive society, of a white supremacist society. They're fulfilling it to the T. And therefore, a movement that could have and should still be a critical tool in our arsenal is lost in the name of short-term power and victory over men. They're not seeing the big picture. And what I'm saying today would be considered quite reactionary. So long ago. But our people knew a long time ago what was important in order for our collective survival. They knew it. It wasn't the perfect system, but it was the best that they could do to stave off the inevitable. And the other inevitable had to do with utter and complete destruction for everyone. So I encourage us to think about the moment that we're in. I encourage us to be mindful that our number one imperative, when all is said and done, is survival. If you still recognize that you are a member of an oppressed group, your number one imperative is survival. And how do you survive? You hold fast to systems, because that's what they are, that help us from day to day, keep ourselves together, keep our identities together, keep our families together. We are encouraged to think that families are passé. You don't necessarily need a family anymore. Yes, you do. Even if you make your family, you can make a family and achieve the same goals and objectives. I have a circle of friends who, without them, I just don't know how we've gotten through this past couple of years. I have no idea how I would have made that. And I have seven brothers and a sister. I have a big biological family. But they, what I was going through, they couldn't offer. And certainly not totally. So I have to lean on my family. And that's how I managed to pull through. And still am seeing my way through. That is the lesson that we learned. It's a very important and valuable lesson. And why should we dismiss it? Because I want to feel good in this moment. I want my revenge. I want my kind of justice. It's never going to work. So I ask you to consider the moment we're in and to have the courage to say, I'm not going there. I can't go there with you. Because because it's certainly destruction for me. I can't go there with you. But I will call your attention to the fact that you're going someplace where you are not going either. And I am clear what will keep me going. I'm clear about what my survival depends on. And it is not a war. I don't need any wars. Not in my family, not in my community, not in this country. We don't need it. And we have to find a better way to resolve our conflicts. Because if we don't, we certainly are done for. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation, Eutrice. At this time, I'm going to ask if you have a question to ask. You can write a short question. We have paper and pencils outside of the donation area. If you could write a one-sentence question, preferably printed the question, as I say, I don't want a dissertation, Eutrice is able to answer some questions. So let's take a break of about 5 minutes. You want to go back there and get some paper, and Julie here will collect the questions. It'd be preferable if you print it, because I can't read scribble scraps. So please, if you'd like to get a paper, and if you don't have a pen or pencil, there's pencils and paper back. So let's take a break of about 5 minutes, allow you to do that, and if you care to give a donation, that would be appreciated.
In love with the duopoly that is the Democratic and Republican Party? Why are some of us still in love with Barack Obama and Bill Clinton? Oh, Lord. It's comforting to sweat. It's like anything else. Some of us are still in love with the things that are not good for us, because we're not interested. We're not interested in being any other way. We're not interested. Because even if you're in love with somebody, you should still not part with your senses, right? You should still be able to be objective about these things. And you know when somebody's not good for you. And it's a matter of what would it take? What really would it take for you to see the light? And for some people, you just have to leave them alone. I keep talking about Harriet Tubman having to threaten to shoot some of the people she was trying to save. That's where we will end up at one point or the other. We'll have to make a decision to leave some people behind. We cannot afford to have them retard our progress.
Amen.
If you want to love Bill Clinton, good for you.
All right.
You and, you know, Bill Clinton, may you share a bright and prosperous future together. But I can't handle that. You can't, you're a finite person, you can't take on infinite tasks. So if there are people who love them, good. Maybe you really do need to be brought to your knees. But in the meantime, I'm moving along. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.